Distinguished Lecture Series. I'm Karen Matthews of University Video Communications. Our program is designed to enrich graduate and upper division curriculum with academic presentations by top computer scientists in industry. Speakers and topics were nominated by computer science faculty from over 50 universities. This presentation is sponsored by IBM Almaden Research Center. Dr. Nicholas Pippenger, a leader in theoretical computing research, received his PhD in electrical engineering from MIT in 1973. He then joined IBM, where he is now a fellow with the IBM Almaden Research Center. His talk today is The Complexity of Addition. It's our pleasure to introduce Dr. Nicholas Pippenger. Dr. Pippenger.
Let me begin by explaining what I mean by addition and by complexity. Here I've indicated schematically an addition problem. I'll be dealing with the addition of numbers represented in binary, and for the most part, I'll ignore problems of representing negative numbers. So here we have two natural numbers represented in binary notation. One of them, x, is represented by x naught, its least significant bit, through x of n minus 1, its most significant bit, so it's an n-bit binary number. Similarly for y, and we wish to form the sum, z, of these two numbers as represented by n plus 1 bits, z naught through zn. On the next slide, you'll see the basic components by which we hope to carry out the operation of addition. I've indicated here a typical gate. It's a device with some number, in this case two, input terminals and one output terminal. This particular gate computes the so-called NAND function. It produces a 1 at its output unless both of its inputs are 1. Okay. On the next slide, you'll see a network built up of NAND gates. Here are four NAND gates connected together in such a way that there are no cycles of dependency. There are two inputs to the network. Signals, zeros or ones, flow along the wires. You can see here that it's possible to compute something once and use it several times. This network has one output. And you can find out what it does by imagining zeros or ones being put in at the inputs and then propagating through the network to find out what comes out the output. If you do this in all four possible cases, you'll find that this network computes the exclusive or sum modulo 2 of its two inputs. So the output will be a 1 if precisely one of the two inputs is a 1. Now, we'll use networks such as these, with perhaps more inputs and outputs, for adding numbers in binary. And we'll be interested in minimizing certain characteristics of these networks. One obvious characteristic, which is related to the cost, is simply the number of gates in the network. Okay, this network has four gates. Another characteristic related to the delay of the network, or the time that must pass between the time that inputs are presented to the network and the output is available, is the depth of the network. The depth of this network is 3 because the longest path from any input to an output is of length 3. There are several paths that pass through this gate, one of these two gates and that gate. There are no paths that pass through all four gates. Okay. I've chosen, for the purposes of this talk, to concentrate on networks built out of NAND gates, but the results that I'll be talking about would be much the same, with modifications and constant factors, if I used any other finite set of gates which had the property that from them you could construct a network computing any Boolean function. The NAND gate alone has that property, but if you chose any other such set of gates, you could, from them, construct a network that would simulate a NAND gate, and similarly, using NAND gates, you could construct networks simulating whatever gates you had in the other set. And so, the sizes and depths of these of networks constructed in these two ways would differ by at most constant factors. On the next slide, you'll see what's perhaps the most obvious way to attempt to compute the sum of two numbers in binary. The essence of the computation is the calculation of the carries. So I've indicated setting the carry into the zeroth order position, the lowest position, C0 to 0, and then imagine a finite state machine proceeding from right to left along the binary representations of the inputs, remembering in its finite state the carry as it goes. In doing so, it will compute each sum as the sum modulo 2 of the two add ends at that position together with the carry from the preceding position. And simultaneously, it will compute the carry out of that position, which is the carry into the next position, as the majority of those three items. Okay. Continues that way until it reaches the end of the inputs, and the carry out of the highest position, it becomes the largest digit of the sum. The sum might have one more bit than the add ends. So imagine now building a small network out of NAND gates or any other type of gates with some definite size and some definite depth that performs the core operation that I just described. It takes a carry in and two add end bits, and it produces the sum corresponding to that position and the carry out. Okay. By interconnecting a number of these equal to the length of the binary numbers to be added, you can construct an adder of arbitrary size. The carry into the lowest position is simply a zero. You can imagine any sort of network that provides a zero signal up there. And the carry out of each position is fed into the next position. Letting C denote the number of gates, or I'll call it simply the size, of a network for processing adding numbers of length n, it's easy to see that that will simply be proportional to the number of bits in the input, which I'll indicate big O of n. Similarly, the delay, or the depth, will also be proportional to the number of bits. The longest path through the network will start at one of these inputs and proceed through all of the carries to end up at one of these outputs. On the next slide, you can see an attempt to decide how close the bounds that we've just obtained come to the best possible. Now, here I've indicated a network with seven gates and having depth 3 and 8 inputs. Okay. So the number of inputs is just one more than the number of gates. And it's easy to see that in any network in which all of the gates have just two inputs, if the output depends on all of the inputs to the network, then it will certainly have at most one more input than the number of gates. Similarly, the number of inputs can at most double each time you add one to the depth of the network. The depth of the network must grow at least as the logarithm to the base 2 of the number of inputs. So from these considerations, which apply with slight changes in the constants to any other set of gates you might imagine, we can see that the bound we obtained to the size of the network of order n is the best possible. In other words, the size of a network must be at least some constant times the number of inputs. I've indicated that C equals big omega of n. But the delay or depth that we obtain might not be the best possible, because this argument only tells us that it has to grow at least as the logarithm of the number of inputs. And what we obtain grew in proportion to the number of inputs. It's not at all obvious that it's possible to add two numbers with a delay that's proportional to the logarithm of the number of inputs. It is possible, and the first three works demonstrate this. All had the property that the size of the networks achieving that bound grew faster than linearly with the number of inputs. So although the depth dropped from order n to order log n, the cost in doing so increased from n to order n log n. However, on the next slide, you'll see that it is possible, as was discovered by Yuri Offman around 1960, to construct networks for addition that simultaneously have cost or size proportional to n and depth or delay proportional to the logarithm of n. And I'd like to take a few minutes to explain how this can be accomplished. I mentioned before imagining a finite state machine which proceeds from right to left through the numbers to be added, at each stage remembering the carry out of one position and into the next position. And what I've tried to indicate here is that the possible pairs of inputs that the machine can encounter during any step can be classified into classes describing what effect they have on the remembered carry. Okay. And I'll use W sub I to indicate the class corresponding to position I. There are three possible classes. If both inputs are zero, then a carry will be absorbed if it occurs from the preceding digit, and no carry will be produced out. Similarly, if both inputs are one, a carry will be generated by this position, no matter whether there's a carry in or not. And in the remaining two positions, where one of the inputs is a one and the other is a zero, a carry will be propagated, meaning that a carry will be produced out of the position if and only if a carry comes in from the next lower position. On the next slide, you can see that if you have a group of columns or positions, then as far as their effect on carries is concerned, they behave more or less like a single position. Imagine that I have two positions, the I and the I plus first. If the more significant position absorbs a carry, then no matter what the next lower position does, and no matter what comes in, no carry will be produced. Okay, so if the high order position absorbs, then no matter what occurs in the next lower position, the pair of positions will act to absorb a carry. Similarly, if the higher order position generates a carry, no matter what happens in the lower position, the group of positions will generate a carry. If the higher order position propagates a carry, then what happens does depend on the next lower position, and the group of positions will either absorb, propagate, or generate a carry according to whether the next lower position absorbs, propagates, or generates a carry. Okay. I've used two circles, one within another, to indicate this operation on the classes of possible pairs of inputs. So you can imagine multiplying an A or a P or a G by another A or P or G to get a result, which is again an A or a P slide. I've shown a black box, which is supposed to contain some number of gates and to perform the operation I've just described. In other words, it takes a pair of signals on wires describing an A or a P or a G corresponding to WI and another pair corresponding to WI plus 1 and produces at its output the representation of an A or a P or a G that describes the pair of consecutive positions. Now, once we have a box such as this, then we can interconnect them to show on the next slide. A larger network, which you should imagine being constructed entirely out of little boxes of the type I just showed. Okay. What it will do is take at its inputs the descriptions of W naught through WN minus 1, in other words, descriptions of what the inputs will do to carries. Those are simple functions of X and Y, as we've already seen. And will produce at its output descriptions of what various suffixes or rightmost subsequences of positions will do to carries. So at its rightmost output, it will reproduce its rightmost input, which describes what the rightmost position does to carries. The next pair of outputs will describe what the two rightmost positions do to carries. And finally, its leftmost output will describe what all n positions taken together due to carries, so it represents the composition using that double circle function of W sub n minus 1 through W sub 0 in that order. And here we come to the heart of Offman's construction. This shows how to build up a box such as the one I've just shown out of smaller boxes that either compute the two-circle operation on carries or are recursively constructed according to the pattern I'm describing. Here I've shown an example for n equals 8. And each of the lines that I've shown proceeding vertically in this diagram really represents two wires for the two wires, the two signals that it takes to represent A or P or G. The first thing we do is take the inputs in pairs and combine the A or P or G corresponding to each pair to produce a single A or P or G representing what the pair does. Okay. Now that we have half as many things as we started with, we can recursively construct a box to process those. So its rightmost output will be the result of combining the bottom two. Its next rightmost output will be the result of combining the bottom four, next rightmost the bottom six, and its leftmost the bottom eight. So you see we've got all of the even outputs at this point, and it's not hard to see that each of the remaining outputs can be generated by combining one of the even outputs that we've already computed with one more of the inputs to bring it up to the next larger odd number. Okay. So if we started with a box that processed the carries for four inputs, then we've managed to build a larger one that deals with twice as many, namely eight inputs, by adding a number of additional boxes that's less than the number of inputs, it's seven, and by adding two levels of delay to the network, because we've added a few boxes ahead and a few boxes after the network. So doubling the number of inputs requires doubling the cost, roughly, and adding a constant to the delays. The cost will grow linearly with the number of inputs, the delay will grow logarithmically with the number of inputs, and with that, we will have computed all of the carries, and as you saw slides, once you have the carries and the inputs, you can easily compute all of the sums just by taking the sum modulo 2 of the input positions with the carry for that position. So on the next slide, you can see a summary of what we've accomplished. We've managed to add two binary numbers of length n using a network that has a size proportional to n and a depth proportional to the logarithm of n. And if you think about it, the only property that of addition that we've used in doing this is the fact that it could be carried out by a finite state machine proceeding from right to left along the input and just remembering, in the case of addition, a carry at each stage. So you should have no trouble at all applying the same principle to other problems that can also be computed in this way. Here I've shown, for example, the problem of dividing a number with n plus 1 bits represented in binary by a fixed constant 3, in this case, to produce a quotient which will have one fewer bit and a remainder which will have 2 bits. That can be computed by a finite state machine crawling from left to right over the input. Okay. Similarly, but just slightly more complicated, would be the example of dividing a number represented in decimal by a fixed constant such as 11, okay, to obtain a quotient and a remainder, always with a number of gates proportional to the number of inputs and a depth or delay proportional to the logarithm of the number of inputs. I'd like to switch now to a different model of network. We considered before gates that had two inputs and computed the NAND of those two inputs. Imagine now that we can procure gates that have any number of inputs and still compute the NAND of those, say, L inputs, meaning that they produce a 1 unless all of the inputs are a 1, in which case they produce a 0. Because it's only natural to assume that larger gates, that is, gates having more inputs, will cost more, we can take as a first approximation that the cost of a gate is proportional, or if we choose units correctly, equal to the number of inputs. But I want to take the delay introduced by a network, in other words, its contribution by a gate, its contribution to the depth, to be constant, or 1, independent of the number of inputs. Now, it's not really true that one can construct arbitrarily large gates computing a function like NAND within a bounded amount of time. However, there are technologies like programmed logic arrays where the delay is independent of the number of inputs over a sufficiently large range that they're better modeled in this sort of way than is interconnections of small gates, such as the ones I showed before. On the next slide, you'll see an example that shows that with this notion of unbounded fan-in for the gates, we have to be much more careful than we were before about exactly what the gates compute. Before, if you introduced a new gate that would compute the exclusive OR or sum mod 2 of two inputs, then that could change the cost or the depth of the network by at most constant factors, having that available. But here you see a network computing the exclusive OR of n inputs, sum mod 2 of n. If it's constructed out of unbounded gates of the type I've just described, then if the depth of the network is fixed, in other words, if there's a fixed number of levels of gates in it, then the cost not only grows faster than linearly in n, it grows as the exponential of some root of n, where the root depends upon the So this shows that it's no longer true that the size and depth of computing various functions will be insensitive to the choice of what the basic gates compute. What I say from now on will apply only to networks constructed of large NAND gates, although it would happen to apply to those constructed from large AND and OR gates together with inverters. Okay, on the implicit in the earlier result of Weinberger and Smith that I mentioned as achieving logarithmic depth is the fact that addition can actually be performed using the model of unbounded gates in a fixed number of levels, four in the case of these unbounded NAND gates. Unfortunately, when you do that in the most obvious way, the cost becomes very large indeed. Weinberger and Smith result gives a size proportional to the cube of n. So the natural question comes just as before. Can we simultaneously achieve the best possible size and depth bounds for addition with one network? Certainly the size bound of order n that we had in the case of bounded fan-in continues to apply in the case of unbounded fan-in. And we've just seen that a depth bound of a constant is possible. The question is not whether either is possible separately, but whether both can be achieved by the same network. The first step in deciding this question was taken almost three decades later by Ashok Chandra, Steve Fortune, and Richard Lipton. They showed that by slightly increasing the depth of the Weinberger-Smith construction from 4 to 10, the cost could be dramatically decreased from n cubed to n times the square of log n. On the next slide, you'll see a function that's needed to describe further improvements due to Chandra, Fortune, and Lipton. The logarithm is a slowly growing function, but to describe these further results, we'll need still more slowly growing functions. Let me define the log star of n to be the minimum number of times that you have to take the logarithm, say the logarithm to the base 2 of n, in order to get something that's at most 1. So log star assumes the value 0 at 1, the value 1 at 2, the value 2 at 4, the value 3 at 16, 4 at 65,000, 5 only at 2 to the 65,000. So it's a very slowly growing function indeed. Chandra, Fortune, and Lipton showed that by adding another 6 to the depth of their networks, they could reduce the complexity from order n times the square of log n to order n times the square of log star n. On the next slide, you'll see how they went even further. Define the log with two stars of n to be the minimum number of times that you have to take the log star of n to get something at most 1. I won't even try to indicate with examples numbers that would cause this function to take values on the order of 5 or 6. And similarly, having done that, define the log with k stars to be the minimum number of times you have to take the log with k minus 1 stars of n in order to get something at most 1. Okay. Then, on the next slide, the final result of Chandra, Fortune, and Lipton on the addition problem was that by adding about 6k to the depth of the network, you could add k stars to the logarithm. So you had a network whose size was just barely non-linearly. It grows faster than linearly, but by an amount that could be made more slowly growing than any elementary function. On the next slide, you'll see the answer to the question of whether bounded depth and linear size could be achieved simultaneously. The answer is no, and this was first shown in a paper by Danny Dolev, Cynthia Dwork, Avi Vigdorsson, and myself. If you fix the depth of the network at, say, 4, then this result shows that the size has to grow at least as n times log star of n. And the bounds on size and depth differ from the upper bounds obtained by Chandra Fortune and Lipton only in that there's no squaring of the log with the stars and that the stars accumulate at a slightly slower rate. So we've seen that addition can almost be performed in constant or bounded depth and linear size, but not quite. In this respect, it differs from some other functions that could also be computed by a finite state machine traversing the input once from left to right or right to left. For example, imagine a machine that computes the OR of all of the bits it's seen so far. Okay, this would be represented by a network similar to the one we used for processing carries, which produces the ORs of various suffixes or rightmost subsequences of the inputs. Chandra Fortune and Lipton observed that such a network can be built with gates of unbounded fanon with a size proportional to the number of inputs and a depth that's a constant. And you might amuse yourself by trying to prove that result for yourself. A depth of about 7 or 8 is sufficient to obtain linear size. What I've tried to indicate in this last slide is the effect that switching from the model of bounded fanon to the model of unbounded fanon has on our picture of a small part of the computational universe. We saw that when we had bounded fanon, all of the functions that could be computed by a finite state machine making one pass over the input were of essentially the same complexity, namely linear in the cost and logarithmic in the delay. Okay, so for example, it was unimportant whether a machine computed the OR of all the things it's seen both so far, the carry propagation function, or the exclusive OR, the sum by 2. Okay, by switching to unbounded fanon and restricting the depth to be bounded, we saw that the carry propagation function had a very slightly nonlinear cost for each fixed depth, whereas the OR function had a linear cost even for a fixed depth. And we also saw in the Al-Hasted result that the exclusive OR sum mod 2 function had an enormous, almost exponential cost when you restricted the depth. So restricting the depth and allowing unbounded fanon acts as a sort of microscope that allows us to zoom in and separate the computational complexity of problems that previously seemed equivalent. You might think of this as the tip of the iceberg, but that's really an inverted metaphor. This is the base of an enormous mountain that extends up to functions much more complicated than the exclusive OR. Thank you for your attention. We'll now have some faculty questions.
I'm Judith Lemon from University Video Communications. Our first faculty question is from Purdue University. Nick, what is the computational complexity of other arithmetic functions and computing algebraic functions on the same model?
Well, when we move from addition to more complicated arithmetic functions, we move from a realm where we have matching upper and lower bounds to one where we know much less about what's going on. Subtraction behaves in all respects the same way as addition. However, for multiplication, although we can perform it by networks of logarithmic depth and bounded fanon, best bound to size that's known grows faster than linearly. It grows as n times the log of n times the log of the log of n. And that can be achieved by networks of logarithmic depth. For division, we know even less. It can be done in logarithmic depth, but by extremely large networks. So that's about n to the fourth. It can be done with a cost proportional to the best bound we know for multiplication, but only with a much larger depth, like the square root of log n. For other algebraic functions, taking the square root, for example, the situation is the same as for division.
And from University of Arizona, what connection do your results have, if any, to the problem of minimum addition chains?
Well, the main connection is they both involve the word addition. My talk was concerned with the problem of performing addition in terms of less complicated operations, say Boolean operations on zeros and ones. The problem of addition chains concerns regarding addition as a primitive operation and using it to perform the more complicated operation of multiplication by a constant.
Okay. And from Stanford University, you used unbounded gates to compute products in a finite semigroup. What are the bounds for an arbitrary finite semigroup, and does monotonicity make a difference?
Well, if you ask what are the bounds for the models I described for an arbitrary semigroup, they turn out to be, in the worst case, just as the same as the one I described for addition modulo 2. On the other hand, it's possible to discern a finer structure to the problem by talking about reductions between problems of computing products and finite semigroups. And in that sense, there is a worst or most complicated finite semigroup, which is the alternating group on five elements, to which all other finite semigroup problems can be reduced, which therefore forms a natural maximal element. For the question about monotonicity, the question only comes up when you have finite semigroups that whose product operation can be computed using monotone circuits. The complexity of the OR function that I mentioned changes if you consider monotonicity. It can no longer be done in bound depth of linear size. For most of the other semigroups, there's no change.
Okay. And for our final question, when you're dealing with theoretical questions, or when a theoretical computer scientist deals with theoretical questions, how do you choose which ones to target?
Well, that's a very complicated issue. There is a certain value system that's imposed on the universe of possible problems by one's peer group, what things are regarded as being interesting and important at a given time. This represents a consensus and involves a number of different factors like mathematical elegance, technical difficulty, relevance to practical problems. In addition to that, I think most individual researchers have certain internal reasons for looking at problems. I feel, for example, a certain sense of rightness about a problem when I feel that the technical means available are adequate to solve a problem that acts as a certain stimulus for me to pursue it with enough energy to reach a conclusion.
out your feedback on today's presentation, and we hope you will make nominations for future speakers and topics. For these purposes, we have provided you postcards under the label on your video cassette case. Thank you again.